from wherever you are around the world. Welcome and thank you for joining us. Today we're going to be exploring a Cuban Countess. That's right. The book is called La Belle Créole, right here. A wonderful biography of a famous Cuban aristocrat. We're going to find out more from Alina García-Lapuerta. She holds degrees in international economics from Georgetown University's School of Foreign Service and international relations from Tufts University's Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. Let's welcome Miss Alina García-Lapuerta to the circle. Welcome.
Hello. How are you?
Great. This is exciting stuff. Fellow Cuban. Never heard of her. This is interesting. So before we get to a little bit more details about who this lady is, why did you write this book and how did you find her?
Well, I found her in a Miami bookstore, so I guess that's not surprising in some ways. typical for a Cuban. No, she actually was very well known, and she wrote a book in 1844, actually, about a trip she did back to Cuba because she was living in Europe. And that book basically chronicles colonial life in 19th century Havana. And it's still quoted today. And I saw some quotes in those, what I call those big coffee table books, you know, those big photography books on old Havana, the palaces, the houses, and things like that. And they will often quote her to describe what life was like in those palaces, in those houses, because she was related to all the families that lived in those places. And I was very curious because they would just, you know, in passing comment that, you know, there was this, she was Cuban, she lived in Paris, she was married to a French general, and I just thought, what was a Cuban doing in 19th century Paris? I became very, very curious about her, and I started looking into her. And as I said, she was once very, very famous, so there have been biographies in Spanish written about her. Her works are still available in Spanish and in French, and she comes up a lot in, you know, if you're looking into colonial Cuban history or the literature of Cuba and things like that.
Actually, but she's a bit forgotten. I get the funny feeling the audience is probably wondering, what is her real name?
Her real name is Mercedes Santa Cruz y Montalvo. So Mercedes Santa Cruz y Montalvo, and she was known in Spanish as the Condesa de Merlin, which means the Countess of Merlin, which was her French name. Yeah, her husband's name. And unfortunately for her, while she's in Spain, Napoleon takes over Spain, and she's caught in what's called in English the Peninsular War. So she lives through all that. Her family is very politically active. Her great uncle, who was very close to them, becomes actually Minister of War for Napoleon's brother Joseph, who becomes king. They're part of the French supporting group. It's like a civil war going on. So she kind of lives through this thing where she's constantly being evacuated from Madrid, going here and there, and they sort of marry her off to a French general. And when Napoleon loses in Spain, she's exiled to France. And then she arrives in France, and she recreates herself as by hosting a musical salon. She becomes incredibly famous celebrity in Paris of the 19th century. And salons in that time, it's a very big thing in France. And she becomes very, very, as I said, she's always in the newspaper. She launches lots of careers in the musical world. She knows everybody who's well-known in music, in literature, in politics of the time. And she has a great voice. Sorry.
If I can actually stop you for a couple seconds. Yeah. Two questions that pop up in my head. Before I lose either one of them here. Father... He was in the picture early, disappears early. What happened to the dad? Where was he at?
Her father was actually, he's quite famous in Cuban history. He was one of the wealthiest men in Cuba, and he became very high-ranking military officer. He was in Cuba. He was the man who helped map out Guantanamo, actually, and places like that. He was very important, very close to the king. She adored her father. I mean, when he came back when she was about 8.5 years old, and that's when she met him, and she just adored him. When you read her memoirs, because she wrote some memoirs about growing up in Cuba, you can just see that she loved her father, and her father was very close to her. He unfortunately died relatively young after she had gone to Spain, and he left an incredibly complex estate. I mean, lots of litigation. Everybody was fighting for it. He owed, you know, a huge sum of money for, you know, back in that time period, a huge sum of money to the government and to almost half the island, I think. And that went on for like about 30 years, which really affected her life in lots of ways. So yeah, it was an interesting thing. Once he left back for Cuba after he left her in Spain, she never saw him again, and then he died.
Do we know how old she was when he died?
She was about, it was 1806. She was about, I think about 18 years old or so, something like that. I'd have to count a little bit, but okay. She hadn't seen him for 5 years. Yeah, she was 18 years old exactly. Yeah. He left her when she was 13, and then he died when she was 18.
So that's not, let's clarify that salon thing. So what's going on salon. Here?
Okay. So salons just mean a gathering, like a regularly scheduled party, so to speak. Every week you would host on a certain day, you would have people come over to your house. That was a salon. And in France, salons before the French Revolution, during the Napoleonic era, in the time that she lived there, they're an incredibly important part of everyday life of society. It's where you can gather influential people, you talk, you present music. Music was very popular at the time. Music was considered probably one of the most important things of the time. And all the great musicians of that time period would go to Paris, because Paris was like a cultural capital of Europe. So you had people like Chopin, you know, Liszt, trying to think, opera composers like Rossini, you know, singers of the day, they would all go to Paris. And she hosted, in her own home, the most popular of these musical salons.
How
and
did she
everybody
get them?
Went. How did she get them? She was a very talented amateur singer herself. At that time, if you came from kind of like an upper class family, it was taboo to perform in public or for money or to be a professional. So she would only sing, you know, as an amateur. But she knew everyone and they really respected her. And her salon became known. The phrase that they used at the time was that it was the passport to celebrity. So if you were like a new artist who would arrive in Paris and wanted to make your name, if you were invited to sing at her salon, at her private concerts and such, you could really, you know, you would get to meet all the important people who could make your career. And she had a very strong tie to all these artists, and they were happy to perform for her at her house and for charity concerts that she would organize for free. Whereas maybe if they would be hired by, for example, the Rothschilds, who were a very, you know, wealthy family, banking family at the time, they would charge them per piece of music that they would sing or such like that to, you know, sing at their parties. But at Mercedes's parties, they would do things for free because of this strong bond that she had with them and how she promoted their artistic careers. And she really did know everyone. And it was always covered in the press. It's an interesting concept.
Hello, my name's Matt and I'm an addict.
My mom was addicted to prescription pills when I was very young, before I even turned one.
Are you or someone you know struggling with alcohol or drug addiction? Has everyone given up on you or your loved one? The caring staff at Elite Care understands and treats you as a whole person. We offer individual and group therapy, holistic healing such as yoga, nutrition, and spirituality, medication management, and PTSD treatment. By building upon your strengths and rebuilding broken bonds, we help you begin a successful life. With our staff of licensed psychotherapists and doctors, you can be assured of the highest level of care. Elite Care is the best option for long-term rehabilitation from drugs and alcohol. Contact 888-511-0607 for more information.
Now, with all that, that kind of almost generates power. Does she use that power politically at all?
She knew everybody that was politically important. She did use it in a way when it came to the writings about Cuba that she did later on. She used a little bit her connections also to promote. She started writing memoirs and a few other types of books. And she used a lot of these contacts, sort of the way people use them today, networking and, you know, trying to get favorable press coverage and, you know, sort of as a marketing tool. It's a very modern. You would think that that's a very modern concept, but they were actually doing it way back then, you know. And she, when it came to Cuba, though, she did try to use some of her contacts to, gets a little, we're kind of getting ahead of ourselves here, but she used it to promote a little bit a certain view of Cuba that some of the more forward-thinking liberal intelligentsia of Cuba were trying to promote. People who were trying to come up with the idea of maybe of a Cuban identity, There was a lot of tension with Spain at that point, so they were starting to think that maybe they needed to be separate from Spain, but they weren't sure. And they wanted to kind of promote their side of the story to Europe. And it was very difficult for them to get heard, but she had so much celebrity that when she published a book on Cuba, people would actually, you know, they would cover it in the newspapers, they would serialize it, and people might actually read it because it was written by this well-known person. So in that sense, she did use her connections.
Well, I know I don't want to give the whole book away. This is good for people to get it so they can really get into the story. We have a few minutes left. Right. Once again, here's the book, La Belle Créole. Definitely read. It's a fun read. If you're Cuban, you must read it. A couple questions here. What's your opinion on this? Because it looks like she's, I don't know, I can't remember when she passed away. And I don't know.
1852.
What was it?
1852.
Okay. So, does she have any influence at all in her, maybe her beliefs? Did it influence the revolutionary hero in Cuba, José Martí?
I don't know about José Martí because he's a little bit after her, but she was really involved with people. I don't know if you like Cuban history, you might hear the name Domingo del Monte. You might hear the name José Antonio Saco. You might hear those types of names. Lucy Caballero. These are all like really big names if you start digging into Cuban history. And these were like the precursors of Martí. You know, these were the people who were first starting to think, actually, we're not just Spaniards, we're actually Cubans. We're actually a little different. And not everything that Spain wants to do might be the best for Cuba. And that's the precursor of all those 19th century people like Martí and stuff who then fought for Cuban independence.
So there might be a
and
slight influence there.
And she's very tied into that. Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, it's kind of interesting comment. My wife, who's not Cuban, says the same thing. We are a little different, she says. Do you think anything was taken there by Fidel? Did Fidel try to capture anything here or not?
No, but it's interesting because, you know, given that the revolution obviously is like, you know, everything that came before is not necessarily good and you want to sweep that away. It's interesting that now when you go to Old Havana, all the places that she lived in or described or wrote about, they're all the places that are now being refurbished for the tourists. So after spending, you know, decades, so to speak, bad-mouthing anything to do with the aristocracy or whitewashing them from the history of, you know, what they did before, now you pay money to stay in a hotel that was the house where her father lived and died in, you know, that's right in front of the bay. Or you go into a museum that was once, again, the house that she stayed in when she went back to visit her relatives or such like that. And you see plaques all around the city. Like, in this house, you know, the Condesa de Merlin lived with, you know, her father lived here or so-and-so lived there. So it's ironic that now they're making money off of, you know, of that same history that for a long time I think they didn't really want to talk about.
Human nature's funny that way.
Yeah,
last question here before we go. Actually, second to the last question. The last question will be off the subject of the book, but I always ask every Cuban guest I have, but we'll get to that in a minute. Is there any kind of memories in France? I mean, do they have any kind of statues, any kind of buildings to commemorate her?
No, they don't have any statues that I know of, but her name does come up here and there in, you know, French histories of the time. They did actually republish her memoirs, and which are in French, originally in French. Some of them have been translated to Spanish. They republished them a few years ago because people, you know, do value them in that sense, that it's a record of a time. She has descendants in France. They're all French, actually. And they're all very much, you know, are very aware of her. So, yes, if you look into the history of music and salon and such, her name pops up quite a bit, but there's no monument per se.
Interesting. You're in England right now?
I'm in London right now, yes.
All right, yeah. Thank you again for joining us. Here's the question we ask all Cubans. What's your favorite Cuban dish or dessert?
My favorite dish is my aunt's boliche.
Your aunt's boliche, huh?
It's very specific. It's my aunt's boliche. It's if I go to a restaurant, it's bistec de palomilla. Then I always order that. So.
Oh, that's my dad's favorite.
So it just depends.
Thank you so much again, Ms. Lapuerta, for being on the show. Thank you for being on The Circle. Here's the book, La Belle Créole. You got to get it. It's a wonderful book. Thank you again. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Remember, our motto is simple. Wherever there's psychology involved, even in Cuban French history, we are there. See you next time.